joining us, we're in the book of John. I want to talk to you this morning about life transformation, about seeing change happen in your life. And I don't know if you're about you, but for me, there are things in my life that from time to time I look at and I say, that's something that needs to change. We're going to talk about that this morning. But before we get there, I want to celebrate. There are several folks in the life of our church who have stepped forward and said they want to become shepherds. They want to become group leaders. And so our vision this year that we're focusing on, we believe that every sheep needs a shepherd. We want you in the life of this body to be connected and to be cared for. And so several people, if you follow Justin Jackson, the stuff that he posted on Facebook this past week, we have a number of folks, and I just want to mention those very briefly. Terry Wallace, who you can actually pray for her because she broke her leg in three places right above the ankle, so she's going to probably need some shepherding over the next several weeks. But Terry Wallace, Claire Mitchell, Gary and Sarah Jordan, Lundy and Samantha Kiger, Carl and Amber Lynch, and Joe and Tansy Zook. All of these people have stepped forward and said, we want to be group leaders, we want to be shepherds. So I'm going to celebrate their obedience and just what they're doing right now and say, we're grateful for them. And so I want to begin just giving you an illustration and give you a visual to kind of think about what we're talking about when we think about life change. Everybody remember last year, the whole Flint, Michigan debacle with the water that took place. Basically what happened is the city started drawing their water from a new source in order to save money. And what they didn't realize is that by drawing water from a different source, the source itself was so contaminated that they weren't able to purify it, so that when they actually saw what was happening to the people, it was causing rashes and people were getting sick and the color of the water was strange. When they went in and they tested the water, here's what they found. And tell me if you wouldn't want to consume something like this. Flint, Michigan water, they found the presence of fecal coliform bacteria, plant nutrients, oils, toxic substances such as disinfectant chemicals, and lead. The people didn't realize this, that the source they were using, the source they were drawing from, had a direct effect on the end product. That what it was that they were drawing from had a great influence over what the end product was that they consumed. And so to kind of give you a visual illustration of what we're talking about here, I've got a few objects with me. And one is this obviously contaminated source of water right here. And then I was trying to find a big syringe, and I texted Doc Mitchell. I said, do you have a big syringe? And he probably laughed, said, do I have a big syringe? Like, have you ever seen a syringe that this big? The idea here is, picture this is the source, all right? This is a source. It's contaminated. It's toxic. If you draw from this toxic, contaminated source, what's going to happen when you transfer this toxic, contaminated source into a clean pitcher, into a clean cup? Here's what doesn't happen. The clean container, the clean cup, doesn't change the content from the source. Just because you have a clean container, just because you have a clean source, whatever you have here in your source has a direct effect on what you end up with your product. Now you say, where are you going with this? Here's where I'm going with this. There's some of you, when you look at your life, what you see are some areas that look a lot like this. When you look at your life, you see some areas that have become discolored, some areas that have gotten a little bit dirty, some areas that you know, I need to change in this area. Some of you, you look at your family situation and your family dynamics, and you say, why are my relationships in such a mess, and why is this relationship struggling, and why in my marriage are we having these issues? You look at those areas of your life, you look at the end product, and you say, I don't like what I see. I want to see change happen in this area. And so what you do is you focus on the end product, but what you may not realize is that if you're drawing from a source that's contributing to the end product, you can focus on the end product all you want. If you don't get to the source of the issue, guess what? Those issues are going to continue to resurface over and over and over again, because where the problem appears is often not where the problem needs to be addressed. And so if you're seeing problems that are occurring in your life, you see the end product, you say, I don't like that. Then what I'm challenging you to do this morning is not just to look at the end product, but to go back to the source from which you're drawing, the thing that's causing you to have that end product. And maybe this morning that you think in your relationship with God, things are kind of dirty and things are discolored and I don't have a clear view of Him and I don't feel close to Him and I feel disconnected. It may be because you are drawing from a source of lies, things that you have believed about the character and the nature of God, that He only loves you when you're good or He only loves you when you're productive. And you're drawing from that source of lies. And it's no wonder that today when you look at your relationship with Him, things are discolored. Things are not the way they should be. The reason is not because you've got to go and change the end product. The reason is because you're drawing from the wrong source. I mean, this principle that applies to any area of your life, it may be that you come in here today and you say, you know, financially, things are a mess for me. I feel like I'm always in debt. I'm stressed out. Things are just terrible. You look at the financial picture in your life, and what you may not realize is that you're drawing from a source of discontentment that says, if you'll go and buy more, it'll make you happy. And what you don't realize is that, yeah, there are issues with creditors and bill collectors and people calling you, late payments, but that's not the source of the issue. You see what I'm saying? The source of the issue runs much deeper. And so if we want to see transformation in the end product of our lives, we've got to get to the source. And that's exactly what Jesus helps us see this morning. If you'll open with me to John chapter 15. In this passage, we want to look at Jesus getting to the source, the heart of the issue that causes so much of our problems and so much of our challenges. And so in John 15, the backstory here, as I've said before, Jesus is just hours away from His crucifixion. This is the night before He's going to be crucified. They have left the upper room where they have had a meal together. He and His disciples have departed. Now they're going out into the night, into the evening. Jesus is leading them around, and He comes and He speaks to them these words. And in these first two verses, you see Jesus beginning to paint a portrait for being connected to the source, the importance of the source. Verse 1, John 15. Jesus says, "I am the true vine, and My Father is the vine dresser." So He's giving a metaphor here that His disciples would have readily understood. And there are three characters in this metaphor. There is the vine, who is Jesus. There is the vine dresser, who is the Father. The Father is the one who tends to the vine, who tends to the garden. And in verse 3, He says, "Every branch in Me." Now, you and I, His disciples, are the branches. So you've got the vine dresser, the Father, the vine is Jesus, you and I are the branches. "Every branch in Me that does not bear fruit, He takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, He prunes it so that it may bear more fruit." Now already, just from looking at these two verses here, the second verse makes clear to us that the vine's responsibility is not to produce fruit. And please hear me, the vine's responsibility, or the branch's responsibility is not to go and produce fruit. The branch's responsibility is to stay connected to the vine. The branch doesn't wake up in the morning saying, "I've got to produce fruit. I've got to make this thing happen. I've got to manufacture something." A branch wakes up in the morning and its role, its responsibility is to stay connected to the vine, to draw life from the vine, to go to the vine as the source. And when the branch stays connected to the vine, guess what happens? The branch naturally changes. The branch naturally produces fruit. And this is counter to the way that we tend to think about life transformation. We tend to think in terms of, all right, if I want to see something different in my marriage or different in my home or different in my job, then I go and I take this end result, this outer thing, and I shift it, I change it, I focus on the outer thing. When Jesus says, no, the first thing that you focus on is not the outer thing itself. You don't focus as a branch on producing fruit. You focus on staying connected to the vine. And so Jesus teaches us this in the first two verses. He goes on and He clarifies in verses 3 and 4. He continues. He says, "You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in Me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in Me." Verse 5, He summarizes and clarifies for us, brings together His teaching when He says this, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. What Jesus teaches here is that you and I are the branch. He is the vine. We should look to him as the source of our lives. Our ability to change, your ability to grow, your ability to overcome sin, your ability to be the person God has created you to be is directly dependent upon your connection to the vine. So what we see from this is life change doesn't begin when we say, okay, I'm going to change what's in the cup. I'm going to change how I act. I'm going to change how I relate. Life change begins when we connect to a different source, the source being Jesus. Now, here's a really good trick. And if you want to know a really good trick that I think Satan plays on a whole lot of people, and this is a trick that keeps a whole lot of people trapped into, in bondage to, patterns of behavior, patterns of sin that are wrong. Satan comes along and he says, okay, yeah, you need to connect to Jesus as the vine, but before you connect to Jesus, you need to go ahead and you need to get the inside of your cup cleaned out. You need to go and get rid of all the contaminants. You need to get rid of all of the toxins. You need to go and change your behavior. You need to be more loving in your home. You need to be a better employee. You need to be more faithful in this area. You go and you connect to Jesus, but before you do, fix your life. Before you get serious about following Jesus, fix the junk in your life. Before you connect to a different source of life, straighten your life out first. Now, here's the problem with that. I can probably speak to you. I know I can speak for myself. If that's the way we operate, guess it, when it is that we're actually going to connect to Jesus? Never. Because we never get to a place where we realize, oh, I've defeated this bad habit. Oh, I've defeated this pattern of sin. Oh, I've gone off and I've made these changes to my moral outward appearance. I've cleaned the cup, and so now I can connect to a new source. Now I'm worthy to connect with Jesus. If you're here and you're thinking, okay, yeah, I'll just make these modifications to my behavior and then I can connect to him. Brother, sister, I would just say to you, you're missing the point. The only hope that you and I have to ever see something different happen in our outward behavior, in the way we conduct ourselves, in the end product of our lives, the only hope that we have to see transformation happen there is not to go and get rid of all the contaminants. The only hope that we have is just to go to a source of life that is different, to go to a source of life that is pure. And so in going to a different source of life, what we do is we say that there is no way that we could ever cleanse ourselves to the point that we're going to be worthy to connect with Jesus. So what we are going to do is we're just going to tap into a different source of life. And in connecting to and tapping into this different source of life, we realize that the container itself doesn't have the ability or the power to purify. But what we're realizing in this whole process that Jesus is teaching us is that when we connect to a different source, over the course of time, the end product takes care of itself. And what we need to understand is that where the problem appears is often not where the problem needs to be addressed. And so if the problem appears in your life that you're just a jerk or you're impatient or you're rude or you're whatever, you're struggling with something. If the problem appears there in your home, in your work, in your marriage, the issue needs to be addressed at a deeper level. And the deeper level is you connecting to Jesus, finding a new source from which to draw your life. And when we connect to Jesus over the course of time, he produces something different. But we have to have that connection to and with him. And so the central truth that I want to give you today is this, that life change begins with a connection to Jesus. And to help you to apply this and to think through this, I want to mention here just a few ways that we normally, things that we're tempted to connect to. Because if we're going to connect to Jesus, we've got to figure out what we're currently connecting to that keeps us from connecting to Jesus. Makes sense, right? So if we're going to live with this drawing life from Jesus, going to Him as a source of our life, we've got to figure out what is it that we typically turn to, what are the go-to sources that keep us at times from connecting to Jesus. And I want to give you a list of things that for every person here, you're probably going to find yourself somewhere in this list. Maybe some of you, if you're like me, you'll find yourself on this list in more than one place. But here are some things that we typically go to that are sources we look to draw life from. Here are some things that when we get to a place where we are empty, we are lonely, we are frustrated, here's where we go for life, to feel okay, to feel well. For some of us, we turn to purchasing something. We go and we're not feeling well, we're having a rough day, I need to go shopping. Now, don't anybody raise your hands, but if you do, hey, just consider this. You know, you want to go buy something. It may be that you just turn and you eat something. The way that you medicate your mood, the way that you shift how you're feeling, is that you turn to consuming something physically. It may be that you drink or you take something. Or some of you, maybe you're frustrated, you're mad, you're upset, you're just, you know, you're going to go grab a beer or you're going to take a pill or you're going to do something like that to medicate your mood there. For some of you, maybe you go and you make something. Now, for those of you who are the Martha types, you're super spiritual. This can be as much of a hindrance to connecting with Jesus, because when you get down, when you're not feeling good about yourself, you think, well, I just go create something and produce something, and then I'll feel okay about myself. So you turn to that as the source of your life. It may be that you read something. You go on social media and you just spend time surfing through Facebook and you're bored, and so that's what you do. It may be that you, like millions of Americans, you turn on the old TV and you lose yourself for 3 or 4 hours because you just don't want to deal with the reality of life, and so you just zone out. Now, I'm going to be very clear about this. Is there anything wrong inherently with any of these things? Inherently, no. There's nothing inherently wrong with any of these things. What I'm trying to point out this morning is if we want to connect to Jesus and draw life from Him, if the first place we turn is to one of these things, guess what? It means that we're not turning to Jesus. And these things here, all of them can be enjoyed as gifts from God. All of them can be beneficial. But if these things become the first thing that we turn to, so we're down, we're not feeling well, we have to buy something or eat something or drink something, they're the first things that we turn to. The problem is we are skating on thin ice. And it could very well be the case that we're dealing with idols here. That we're dealing with things that, as Jeremiah said, chapter 2, these are broken cisterns. They're cisterns that don't hold any water. They provide for us, they promise for us that they will provide, but in the end, they don't provide what they promise. So we go to these things thinking, well, if I'll just get this or grab this or consume this, this will make me okay. Hey, all of these things can be fine and well, but if any of these things we turn to first and not Jesus, if these things compete with Jesus, then we need to turn away from them. So evaluate this question. Where do you turn to when you're in a place of need? When you're lonely, when you're depressed, when you're feeling like you need something to fill you up and make you feel okay, do you turn here or do you turn toward Jesus? Because this passage this morning is about helping us to understand that anything other than Jesus is you're drawing your life from a contaminated source. As good as these things can be, that these are not things that are going to help you toward transformation, being the person God has created you to be. So to apply this, let me give you three practical steps. The first step is this, and we've looked at these in the past week, but I want to show you these again and drill a little bit deeper so that we can really begin to live this out. If you want to see transformation happen in your lives, the first step is this, is to study and submit to Jesus' words. Now, I put these same words on the screen this last week, but the question that I want to ask this morning is this: is there anything in your life that has more power over you than Jesus? Anything. Now, we could talk about a lot of specifics, but there are three general things that tend to have power over us, in some cases more power than Jesus. One thing that can tend to have more power over us than Jesus is a person. It's possible that you have had a person in your past, a parent or somebody else who has spoken things to you, spoken things about you. You have believed certain things about yourself. And so when Jesus speaks about you, that you are the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world, when Jesus says of you that the Father in heaven, he knows the numbers of hairs on your head, that you are intimately known, when Jesus speaks his words over you, you can't be submissive to that. You can't receive that. You can't allow that truth to come into your life and set you free. The reason is because there is a person who has defined you more than Jesus. And so somebody has spoken or is speaking things into your life that are contrary to the words of Jesus. And so when Jesus comes along and his word to you is this, that he wants you, child of his, to be free, well, you can't embrace and walk in that freedom because what somebody else has said or done to you in the past has defined how you perceive yourself, and their opinion of you is more important and holds more weight than God's opinion of you. You see how this can be something that keeps us from drawing life from Jesus? It's through a connection to a person. Another thing that can keep us from submitting to Jesus' words, knowing the truth and letting the truth set us free, is a past event. For a number of people, one thing that keeps them from grabbing on to the life that can be theirs in Christ is something that has scarred or shaped them in the past. For me, one of the things that I'm conscious of in this season of my life that keeps me from at all times submitting to Jesus' words and living out who he wants me to be is I feel like my life, I filter so many things through the possibility of dying. And it sounds a bit morbid, and it is a bit morbid, but what I've realized is that, you know some of my story, my brother died when I was a teenager, and my dad passed away unexpectedly a few years ago. And so for me, when I look at all of the good things in my life, the blessings in my life, there's a little voice somewhere in the back that says, don't enjoy those things too much. Don't hold on to those things. Know that those things are here today, but they can be taken from you. There's this little voice that comes inside and says you really shouldn't have happiness. You shouldn't enjoy life because you don't know what's going to happen. And so while it's healthy to be aware of that, it's very unhealthy and it's very toxic to live there. It's very toxic to evaluate all of your current relationships through the prospect of, wow, we're all going to die, and that's depressing. What's happening there is that there is a past event that's influencing how I view the world today. And so when I look at the words of Jesus, I realize, okay, I'm not being submissive to what he says about life in him. And so if I draw from a different source, if I take this old contaminated cup that says, well, you shouldn't enjoy anything and life's so short and just be depressed because it's all going to be over soon, I take this old cup, I set it down, and when I take a new cup, when I get a new source, that new source says, yeah, life is short, it is a mist that appears for a little while and then it is gone, but guess what? Jesus came so that we would in him not have to grieve as those who have no hope. When I draw life from a different source and I tap into Jesus's words, I let them have power over me, I get to a place where I realize, yeah, life is short, but this life on earth, it's nothing but a preparation for a greater destination. The life we have on this earth is 60, 70, 80, 90 years, however long it is just a handbreadth, the psalmist says, to compare to what we have in eternity. And so it reshapes, it transforms the cup. And I could spend my entire days focusing on, oh, you know, I shouldn't be so negative and I shouldn't be so depressed and why am I this way? I could look at the cup, but I've got to look to the source. And I've got to start drawing life from a different source. And those of you who you're defined by something in your past, by what somebody has done to you or what somebody has said to you. You need to start looking into the source, Romans 8:1, that says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You need to walk away from whatever somebody has marked you to be and said you are to be. Walk away from that and say, this is who I am. I'm claiming my identity in Christ, and I can take all of this old junk, all of this old garbage. I can't clear the contaminants out myself, but guess what? There is something in this world that can. It's called the blood of Jesus. And so you go to the cross and you apply the blood of Jesus to this, and guess what? Things begin to change. You begin to realize that God hasn't created you to live in that place of prison. He's created you to live in a place of freedom. You go to the cross and you say, Jesus died for that. I don't have to let that have power over me anymore. And you start walking in freedom. And don't we want that? If believers in Jesus grabbed hold of what Christ did on the cross and through the resurrection, this world would change. This county would change. We spend so much of our stinking time thinking about, well, I've just got this junk in my life. Don't look to your junk. Repent of it. Look to the cross. See that Jesus is the Savior. Jesus is the healer. Jesus is the freedom giver. You're not. And stop trying to change the outward behavior. Connect to a different source. Life change begins with a connection to not your morality, not your hopes, not your efforts. Life change begins with a connection to Jesus. It is Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And so it could be that the thing that is keeping you from doing what Jesus has called you to do, but more importantly, being who Jesus has called you to be, is because of a past event, because of a person, or it could be because of this, and this is something that hits all of us at some point or another. It could be because of a passion that is stirring in you, a desire that is stirring in you, that in and of itself, it's not a bad thing, but if left unchecked, that passion can dominate the drive, the direction, the trajectory of your life. That passion can come along, and it can distort your understanding of why you're here on this earth. And so you have a passion to be a provider for your family. If you're not careful, that passion can become more important to you than Jesus' words, and then you begin to filter everything through, well, I've got to make more money, and I've got to work more hours, and I've got to take on more responsibility, and my family's just going to have to suffer for the time being, but that's just what I've got to do. And the passions that you have that may have been given to you, they're good, they're healthy, but if left unchecked, can become idolatrous. Passion where you think, well, if I could just get married, or if I could just have kids, or if I could just get rid of the kids that I have, or if I could just, you know, this idea that if something in your life could change, then you would be okay. And so you're driven by this passion to see the outside end product of your life change. You're driven by this passion, and what you don't realize is that, hey, it's important to have passion and to have drive. But if you continue to draw from the source of earthly pleasure, you continue to look to this world for your satisfaction, and if there's anything that you look to more than Jesus to make you okay, anything you look to more than Jesus to make you feel like, oh, I'm sufficient, anything at all, then you're drawing from a source that ultimately is going to lead you to the same point of being toxic and contaminated, and the end product is not going to be what you want it to be. So, life change begins with a connection to Jesus. The first way we see this happen is by studying and submitting to Jesus' words. I would encourage you to dig into the words of Jesus, begin consuming those, connecting with those on a regular basis. The second is this: to remain sensitive to the Spirit. The question I want to ask you, and I want to drill in and ask you this question: are you seeking to hear from God? When you open up the Scriptures, are you expecting God to speak to you? When you pray to Him and you're concerned about an issue, are you expecting God to give you a word, to speak a fresh voice into your life? If you're not, then guess what, brother, sister? You are limiting God's ability to produce fruit through you because you've cut yourself off from the source of life. And so if you're at a place where, I don't know what it means to even hear from God, then this day, this may be the only thing you need to hear today. This day begins saying, by God's grace, I'm going to learn what it is to hear the voice of God and to walk in obedience to it. And one place I'm putting an anchor down and I'm saying from this day forward, this is going to change in me, is I want to begin to hear the voice of God, to walk in His ways. And watch transformation begin to happen. The third area is this, and this is what brings these first two together, is to surround yourself with God's people. The question that I want to ask you is this: are you spending time with other believers for the purpose of growing your relationship with Jesus? Now, I said last week, I say again, the challenge we have because we live in the flesh is we're going to tend to stray from this and stray from this. We're going to stray from Jesus' words. We're going to stray from His Spirit. So we need people of God to surround us when we get to a place where we're not being obedient, where we're not being sensitive to the Spirit. We need people to surround us and say, look, it looks like you're veering off path. If you want to see Jesus change you, then you need to get back to the basics of studying and submitting to His Word, of being sensitive to His Spirit. We need people to gather around us. Now, the great thing about this is that at the end of the day, what Jesus wants for us from these things is not so that you could be a more moral person than the person next to you. It's not so that you could stop doing wrong and start doing right. The reason Jesus tells us these things is in verse 11. These things I have spoken to you so that, I love this, my joy may be in you. And look at what happens. When Jesus' joy is in us, guess what happens as a necessary direct consequence of that? That my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Jesus' agenda for you, his vision for you, is that you would have joy. That you would walk in a place of freedom, you would walk in a place of healing, to the point that you realize little by little, day by day, year by year, that walking with Jesus and drawing life from Him, there's a lot more joy to that than there is to drawing life from toxic substances of this world. And brother, sister, verse 11 is my prayer for you. It's my prayer for this church, it's my prayer for God's kingdom, that people would connect to Jesus, and because of their connection to Jesus, begin exhibiting joy to the world that displays the greatness of Jesus Christ, that displays the connection that we have to Him. Let's pray. Father, I thank You this morning for Jesus. I thank You again for His teaching. I pray for every person here who is drawing life from a source that is not of You. I pray for no false guilt, no false condemnation. I just pray for clarity, that You would help us to determine where it is that we are drawing life from. And then in realizing where it is that we're drawing life from, we would turn to You and say, Jesus, we want to return to You as our primary life giver, our primary source, and over the course of time, trust that You are going to produce the fruit You want to see in us. We give You ourselves, we give You ourselves entirely in Jesus' name, amen. The invitation for you today, if you don't know Jesus, the good news is He has joy in store. When you connect to Him, you are saved, you put your faith in Jesus Christ. He wants you to walk in joy. And this morning, if you need to confess your sins and repent, place your faith in Jesus, then that's what needs to happen. For those of you who you've already connected to Jesus, but you're drawing life from sources that are not of Him, you realize that this morning, know this, that Jesus didn't come into the world, and I didn't share this message so that you would feel judged. Jesus came into this world that you would have life And that's what he wants you to walk away from here today. But at this point, it's up to you whether or not you embrace this seed that's planted in your heart and you begin to live it out. And so if you are here and you say, there are sources that I've drawn from that are not of him, I just want to turn away from those. And Lord Jesus, I want you to be my primary source of life from this point forward. And then this day, before you leave here, open your heart up to him and pray that to him. Let's stand together and let's sing.